Howdy fucking howdy, and welcome to episode 5 of End User. I'm David Blue, and that is my puppy Bear, and I'm coming to you from, well, right next to this huge white Christmas tree. I suspect it's not real. I should say we come to you. I have to, in the interest of full disclosure, let me try to get this down. So given today's subject, the Microsoft Surface Laptop 2, I have to disclose to you that I, David Blue, your host, and yeah, he's gnawing on my skull, your host and primary commentator on this issue, was part of an experimental elementary school curriculum from ages 6 to 11, authored by Microsoft. And we really don't know to this day, like, if they brainwashed me or, you know, what sort of effect that program may have had. Although I think it is very safe to suppose that such exposure to the bleakest era in Microsoft Office as a young child probably had something to do with my nearly 25-year-old self finding it worthwhile to sit down and talk to you on the Sunday before Christmas about software. And by you, of course, I mean any search engine crawlers. Hey guys, also any late Christmas shoppers, I promise all. Okay, the verdict is, like, I don't know what the verdict is. I think you know in your hearts that the Microsoft Surface Laptop 2 is a superior option to the new MacBook Air. But hey, I thought I might as well record this on the Microsoft Surface Laptop 2 itself using its, I think, stereo microphones. Can you hear me, Bill Gates? Dad, you fucked over everything. You ruined my life, Billy boy, and you're a coward. I thought, since, unfortunately, though you can probably hear that these microphones are incredible for a computer that weighs nothing, ultimately it's going to end up sounding like we're on a Skype call, which, of course, I hope is a very distant memory for you folks. Stop using Skype immediately. Literally the worst option. If I sound like I've descended into insanity for this episode, it's just, I don't know, I thought it'd be funny. It's hard not to say a lot about a computer, which really isn't that significant. But ultimately, if you're listening to this, you'll be able to view my Surface Laptop 2 review, which begins, okay, so that you can view that by going to bilge.world/surface. And hyperlinked within that written review is just about every relevant possible review of this product and its predecessor. Yesterday, I tweeted a photograph and tagged Microsoft Surface, Microsoft Office. Dieter Bone, because Dan Seifert, who's the only person at The Verge that actually uses one of these, well, he can't be tagged in photos on Twitter. I'm assuming they're all a Christmas break, because the photo I sent off was a great joke. It's very funny. I think you'll like it. It's very funny. I wrote this review exclusively in Office 365. And the reason why, I'm jumping all over the place here, but the reason why I mentioned that is, if you want a traditional single sentence per paragraph type bullshit review, okay, obviously they know what they're doing. If you need those, there's one from Mashable, there's one from The Verge. I think that's about it, because no one actually cares about this computer. We'll get to that in a second. But you know what? I'm just going to even use the keyboard, and I apologize for this, but we're on a Skype call. Remember, things are going to get, you know, they're going to be weird interruptions. Sit back and relax, you ultra last minute holiday shopper, you. Buy the fucking Surface or don't buy a lightweight laptop this year. Okay, if OS X really is a must, I understand, okay, those MacBook Air people out there who are like, finally, the new MacBook Air is here. I know why you love it. I watched the unveiling of that goddamn computer, you know, a decade ago, live. I saw the manila folder thing and thought, hot damn, for whatever reason, even though it actually, like, rationally does not make sense, I think for most people to make sacrifices for thinness. The amazing thing about both the MacBook Air and the Surface Laptop 2 are that I can't find any. This has a longer battery life than any laptop I've ever owned, and somehow has the performance to do what I need to do. But again, getting ahead of myself. This sounds like a sermon, doesn't it? That's the format I should have done this whole thing in. It's just like, I should have released it every Sunday and just done it, that thing where you pause and it feels like a... It's specifically when you're talking to yourself, basically, right? When you're doing this solo. When you pause and it, like, somehow manages to give your words emphasis. This is definitely a Christian radio thing. sorry, I had to clear that up. Speaking of sermons, a little divine voice in the back of my head reminded me that just because Microsoft made the computer and made Windows doesn't mean that it wouldn't come by default set up to make best use of the microphone. I went into sound settings, properties, advanced, and disabled enable audio enhancements. I feel like they weren't enhancing anything. Do you? I don't know, but at least we're now in person. We're meeting in person now. We're not on a Skype call anymore. To be truthful, I haven't actually used the new Skype, but just use Discord, all right? Okay, so since I've gotten so off track, and we're already a few minutes in, and you're fucking pounding drinks, you last Christmas shopper. I can do the spec thing for you. Would that make you happy? Okay. So this particular Surface Laptop 2 sitting in front of me, I don't know if it was on, it was less than $1,000. My employer bought it for me as a tax break, believe it or not. So yes, I have betrayed you, open source people, but I didn't pay for it. So this computer has a 8th generation Intel Core i5 CPU running at 1.6 gigahertz. It's got not the lowest 128 gigabyte hard drive, but solid state, of course. But the, I don't know, there are 236 available, okay? You know, you can figure that out. It weighs, I've forgotten. I think it's, I'm really doing well at this. Guys, just look at PC Mag's comparison, okay? Do you need specs? Why are you comparing specs? It weighs 2.76 pounds. Its competitor weighs just 2.03 pounds. Wait a second, what? I'm sorry, I read that wrong. The MacBook weighs 2.03 pounds. The 12-inch MacBook. Oh no. The MacBook Air weighs 2.75. Once again, the new MacBook Air released shortly after this computer weighs 1/100th of a pound less than my fat ass Surface Laptop 2. Okay, we'll have to get back to that. 256 gigabytes, that's the SSD. It has 8 gigabytes of RAM. And yet, especially with the storage, like 128 in a modern computer is just kind of like, I feel like that's a, it's not even like a rational thing. It's just like, I can't. You know, but truth be told, this computer and I'm not sure if this was intentional, but I could choose to interpret the number 2 as a Roman numeral, as in this Microsoft Surface Laptop 2 is not just the Surface Laptop 2. It's the Laptop 2. This is what comes after everything that's ever been called a laptop up until its release. This is the new generation. In many ways, that's actually true, which is why it's odd that you haven't found anyone else talking about it, is it? Honestly, I never would have considered just like saving up my own money. That sounds really ungrateful. But like, I spent the past year in a Linux frenzy, and this has really brought me back to center in a lot of ways. Again, it's that brainwashing talking. Because I'm now an Office 365 admin. While I'm thinking about it, for God's sakes, can anyone tell me, this is serious, can anyone tell me if my Office 365 subscription, if my office's Office 365 business subscription includes Microsoft Teams? I cannot find what, I don't care. It's fine if we don't. I'm not going to get mad if it doesn't, that's fine. But if it does, I need to know so that, because we're cheap, I want to make sure we use every last available, you know, we get our money's worth from that subscription. If anyone can tell me, can show me how to definitively figure out whether or not our Office 365 subscription includes access to Microsoft Teams, please, please contact me in any way. You know how to do that. You're smart people. Let me just consult my notes here. Since I gave you the specs, let me give you some things that I feel like I'm uniquely qualified to say. Well, actually, the only one really is Alcantara is like a, obviously it's been used in other luxury products and not so luxury products. It's used in a bunch of stuff now. It's the word is a brand, of course. It's a company that owns this material. I really wish I could copyright denim. Wait, that's not even a good joke because I think that's a thing. Anyway, Alcantara's most extensive application by far up to this point has been, like since the 70s, has been in automotive interiors. And damn, it really makes for a great steering wheel. I don't think I've ever sat on Alcantara's. No, yeah, I have. But it's also a rather sensitive material to the absolutely disgusting secretions of the normal human hand. So I'm afraid that I have scuffed the Alcantara already on my Microsoft Surface Laptop 2. I think there's a stain, but here's what I'm going to do, okay? You can do it with me or you can wait until I've done it. I'm going to watch Autoblog's tutorial on how to clean Alcantara, and I'm going to buy, not all, but I'm going to get I'm going to buy the products they recommend in order to clean it, and I'm going to try it on my computer. Ooh, now that actually kind of sounds kind of scary. Bring over your computer.
Yeah.
You know, anyway, that's obviously, so that's probably the actually the only useful thing I've said so far. But at least I snuck it in. We're only 12 minutes out. Okay, so USB-C is a thing that I understand. I didn't quite realize why it was a big deal until Neil Patel mentioned on the, I think it was in the new MacBook Aircast. They did an interview. Anyway, we're making like 4 billion chargers a year, and it's a big waste problem. Wow. Well, you're hearing this live now. You probably can hear the fans spooling up on the Surface laptop too. But it really is a lot to ask for it to record this on Audacity, I think, just because, you know, it's less than £3. Obviously, I marvel at this stuff, so, you know, Harry, I don't test tech. I'll discuss later the laptop that's replaced. The USB-C thing. Let's do this. So the ports on the Surface Laptop 2, there is a USB-A port, a mini display port, a 3.5 millimeter audio jack, and then on the right, there is the charging port, which is kind of hidden, but at least it's magnetic. Thank God. Thanks, Bill. All right, Dan, I'll give you, Bill couldn't have done this. Oh, that's actually profound. Bill Gates does not have the beauty inside him to bring something like this into the world. Sorry, Billy. I think what I'm saying is the I/O compliment is absolutely perfect. Anyone who's like, you know, you can read the literature I've provided you in my review, and you'll eventually find that Microsoft decided not to include it because they don't think USB-C is ready. I'm not ready. Oh, I stole a dongle last night for the first time. But it turns out, unfortunately, I love to alliterate things, but I searched long and hard for a synonym for the word thief starting with a D, and I couldn't find any. The SEO title of my Surface Laptop review, well, I'm assuming it's, unless I come up with something better, is the Surface Laptop 2, was made for me, hang on, something like that. The Surface Laptop 2 was built for me, but you should buy one too. And by that, I mean, I basically realized that I would not change anything about this computer. And that is that's a heavy one. I'm not sure if I said that about the Spectre X360. And it might have been true in that case. But for me, and the way that I use this computer, which is lots and lots of writing and lots of reading online. More writing than reading right now. I don't play video games. Thank heavens, right now I'm not doing any real audio or video editing. I hope I never will. And GIMP being the absolutely stellar piece of software that it is, runs just fine. And okay, so because it's so tiny, there really is like not that much you can say about the user experience. There's not much that's easily visually referenced. Anyway, but I will say the keyboard design with the toggleable function key, and I wish it wasn't trying to be automatic, but I've tried to leave as many things like that to default, because of course the vast majority of people will. It is pretty intelligent. I actually don't know what this computer is doing for me, and for the first time that I can remember, actually, I don't even want to know because I don't have to. There are a few things, like, for whatever reason, auto dimming displays, just don't seem to be something that, even Microsoft's, you know, the big M's challenge, they had to step into the ring and they're like, we have to make that an Apple competitor a real one since no one else will. And I don't know why they can't make auto brightness smooth. They just can't. Yet I don't think I've ever noticed it on any MacBook. I've used, and by that I mean, of course, it's so smooth that you don't see it. I don't know why. That's not for me to delve into, but I've really been saving the big one here, and that's the aspect ratio of the screen. So if you're like me, as I said, and I don't play video games, and I don't want to use something like this laptop to watch video content, really. I don't really watch YouTube anymore because I've been over it you got that out of my system years ago. It's just because I don't enjoy anything. But I don't really want to watch Netflix on this when I do watch Netflix. Just because it doesn't, I don't know. Does that make it not a real computer? Who knows? You'll find out in the next 3 hours in this episode. But I do write and I do read. And the 16:9 aspect ratio, for those of us that really really, really do use our laptops to write, it doesn't make sense. And I guess probably the best way to illustrate that is just open up Microsoft Word right now. If you don't know the, open a document, okay? A regular document that you've been writing. Oh, you don't write? Okay, well, stop listening. Press Alt, V, and then U, and pinch to zoom or scroll to zoom until the edges of that document fit your screen, and you'll notice that the text has become huge and you've only been given a small window into that text. And I'm assuming that you're using a 16:9 aspect ratio because that's been the standard. And man, even though I had very little time to decide which computer to be gifted as a tax break, I think that was ultimately, like, aside from like Dan Seifer, the fact that he's actually been using one, the original one, and that he vouches for it, and that I just didn't want a MacBook Air, and really nothing else in that $1,000 line, like, at least for me personally, it's as a work, I don't know what a work computer is. I hope that it's okay that this is mine, right? I don't know. It's a tax break. I've been using it for some ridiculous shit. But what I'm really trying to say is this display is so wonderful, and it is absolutely the perfect size. I used to have a 13-inch MacBook, so this was back in, because I'm so cool. I had a 2008 13-inch MacBook for the single year that they made the aluminum body design under the name MacBook before they moved them all to MacBook Pro. Okay, the surface is getting hot again. Maybe I'm speaking too loudly. Okay, so, my sister got me a great case for that laptop from InCase. And guess what fits in that case, along with literally, basically a huge stack of documents, and notebooks. And yeah, it's this computer, but it almost, I wish that I had that MacBook to compare. I think I left it in Oregon, and I'm really sad about that. But if memory serves, and you can double check this if you really care, it's like 10 times heavier than the Surface Laptop 2. Let me just talk about that. Let me stop beating around the bush about the portability thing. I thought, what the heck? So the Surface Laptop 2 just came out. And basically, from what I read in the short time that I had to decide, well, it took the last downsides to the computer, aside from the lack of USB-C, which will never be a downside for me, or an SD card, which is absurd to expect from a sub 3-pound computer. But it took the last downsides away from the original Surface in the form of offering Windows 10 instead of Windows 10S. And I'm glad that we didn't have to talk about Windows 10S today, because I've been avoiding research on the subject for a long time. And I think that it'd be in the best interest of all of us if we just tried to forget it, from what I know. We've come a long way from Windows 8, haven't we? Okay, so upon reflection, I have to do an immediate 180 upon that. Microsoft Windows 10S was a bad idea. You'll note that I quoted Neil Patel when the first Surface laptop came out, that was what it shipped with. And that was the problem. All the reviews, you know, adored the hardware, which is, of course, relatively unchanged. It's kind of sad that Microsoft's year-old design with its little update is still, I wouldn't say it, still has so much over its, you know, complete overhaul of the MacBook Air. But Milai noted that with Windows 10S, like running Windows 10S, there's so much less functional difference between the Surface Laptop 2 and the iPad Pro of last year. So I'll let supercomputer.fm, as I mentioned in my iOS 12 review, I'll let them take that conversation about the future of computing as it pertains to the iPad Pro. And I won't even reference the Linux rant, which I ended up concluding my... I don't know, I had to toss it in because I recently had a conversation with my niece, and I guess I never realized that she wanted to know more about technology, and her experience has been, like, I don't know, she doesn't feel welcome, and no one has treated her as if she should learn more about technology. So, yeah, I needed to toss that in there because I had planned to, you know, do a whole, I think Linux might be ready essay. It's not. Not ready. Community's not ready. Anywho, the Surface Laptop 2. Of course, there's this, like, a lot of this is a story, just as the story of my, acquisition of my Spectre X360, which was, I believe, in 2016. I hope so. You know what? I brought the Spectre up because I haven't looked at it in a while. It's still in its anti-static bag, and I'm sure you're enjoying listening to that. Basically, I ended up dumping... it's worth remembering this computer, mostly because it had the best name I'll ever give to any computer, which is Libel. I probably shouldn't have thrown that one away. But this thing... I'm getting it out like I can show it to you. But I kind of want to compare it. It's definitely explicitly of an older age if you found yourself really reading the thing that I wrote about getting a new laptop for the first time in forever. A Best Buy is the best place to lose your mind in America. You will have noted that I actually accidentally bought the old one, but that I didn't care because it's got the Hewlett-Packard text. It's the cool one. It's the special edition. And I'm serious when I mentioned that I'd like to make it into a plinth. If you can help me do that, that'd be great. Okay, so as it pertains to the laptop, to the Surface Laptop 2, it's definitely, even to my obviously untrained and uncultured eye, it's a generation or two away. And the thing that hadn't occurred to me is the big difference in using the two, considering they run the same operating system, is that this Spectre costs more, has a faster processor. I think it had 16 gigabytes of RAM. I'm holding it. It's still exists. I guess I should finish this story. I spilled a bunch of water on it, and then it still ran for another 18 months, and then I broke the power port and took it to a real electronics shop in Portland, and I told him I would. He did all this for free. He took the computer apart and showed me how bad the water damage was, and he was like, it's a miracle that it's been running all this time. And when I say I used it for a year, I mean, you know, you don't know me, but for a 3-month period, my computer was on 98% of the time, and I don't leave my computer idling. So there was water damage, and he was like, yeah, it probably wouldn't be worth doing anything. So if I can keep anyone if I can protect it from getting scrapped, I'm going to mount it on a plinth, because I spent so much time on this computer learning how to build Extratone, and I accomplished a lot on it. But it's heavier, it's got a smaller screen, and maybe I got a bad example. But from the very beginning, it's had this creaky body stuff. Of course, it's like not fully reassembled. No, it wouldn't be fair. But like the actual hinge and the case of the computer was designed. Of course, it's a convertible, unlike the Surface Laptop, in that it just folds straight over, and you can use it as a tablet if you can keep your hands from touching the keyboard. Anyway. That hinge stuff has always been kind of fucked up. And I opened this computer up myself and probably threw an electrostatic discharge on top of all of its water damage when I tried to do that, because I had no idea. I should have realized it, but I had no idea that things had gotten so fucking small. Anywho, rambling now, but I'd like to pay tribute to this computer. And it's remarkable to me how much more effective I am on the Surface Laptop 2, simply because I don't have a terabyte of hard drive space to work with. And I, from the get-go, set up my work OneDrive account, my personal OneDrive account, my iCloud account, and I've basically entered the cloud. I, David Blue, have entered the cloud, and it's a lot more handy than it used to be. I guess what I'm trying to say is that when this Spectre was built, and to an extent, you know, when I bought it, when it was designed, rather, I wouldn't have entrusted the cloud to, and I, you know what I say, what I mean when I say the cloud, I mean OneDrive, Google Drive, iCloud, etc. I don't think I would have trusted it as my primary, vehicle for documents that I'm actively working on. And it's really freeing. It's actually been really freeing to not have to have limited hard drive space. And I think that's actually where the laptop 2, as in the future of laptop computers, is, at least for me. That's the biggest change, is I feel like I am now not only comfortable with, but optimized by the migration to the cloud. So, and I mean, also, it's just because I've gotten better at keeping myself from getting distracted. But, my Spectre is so powerful that I could just, run a lot of shit. And it was a big jump for me, because I hadn't had a laptop in forever. And you know, I'm still from that weird microgeneration you'll find me talking about, where it was when we first were getting into computers, it was cool to just like be able to multitask. Like multitasking felt like I was at the helm of some, I was like, I was at the helm of MI6 or something. Like, that took away, ended up taking away from my ability to be productive, I think, in a lot of instances. Whereas, and it's funny because the Surface Laptop 2 feels more capable, even though it is not technically, because of my own behavior, because I don't multitask. And a lot of that also is because it's like can rapidly reboot. So I reboot this thing all the time. I'm sorry. I've got to stop rambling. I want to double check and make sure. I'm going to set the Spectre down. Okay. Dearest old libel. It's fucking filthy. That's cleaning the Surface Laptop 2. The keyboard really does look gross. I don't know. You guys can chastise me. Maybe I do have like overly sweaty hands or something, but I clean the keyboard like, I don't know, every time I get up, not every time, but, and I wash my hands, and it's not primarily because I want, you know, I think the computer is going to, decay away faster if I leave my disgusting sputum on it, but because I just don't like the way greasy keyboards feel. So then again, I've been talking to myself for over a half an hour now about this stuff, so maybe I am just insane. These self-deprecating jokes, by the way, are not real self-deprecation. I do this because it benefits me. And I hope that you find it entertaining and maybe even occasionally informative in the process. Okay, focusing on my list here, just a few more things. I guess it's okay that I waited this long to mention Windows Hello, which is just Face ID. I was surprised when I first booted up this laptop, which you can see on Periscope if you really want me to, that I actually did the whole setup process without using the mouse or the keyboard, because it's all by voice, Cortana. That's unnecessary, but cool. Windows Hello is just like a really, I also did a quote-unquote demo, which I put on YouTube, which is embedded in the review. I guess this is the first application of Windows Hello, and it's just fucking adorable and reliable. But when it's unreliable, it's just funny, because all you have to do is put your PIN in if it doesn't recognize you, and it will resolve to not recognize you very quickly, unlike Touch ID on iOS, which just, it doesn't give up quite fast enough. I'm sure you know what I mean. I also like that it will be like, oh, you're wearing a hat? That's not you. That's not David Blue. Because it's right. That's not me. What am I doing wearing a hat? Sometimes it doesn't recognize me without glasses or when I'm shirtless. But again, 5-digit PIN. I've never felt inhibited whatsoever from logging onto this computer. In fact, it's like, I am the weak link. It waits on me. And it's incredible, like, the different lighting conditions in which it will recognize me, and the extremity of the angles. I was showing my friend this computer, and I just kind of, like, peeked around the corner so that she could log in, and it was like, oh, there you are. Anyway, bravo on Windows Hello. Can I put Windows Hello on my iPhone? That's my next question. I told you that I love the keyboard, but I did want to, I mean, the only sacrifice, and it's inevitable, is that I am going to have to change my keyboard workflow to omit the up and down arrow keys, because they're just too small to distinguish from one another. But otherwise, this is my favorite keyboard layout, period, I've ever encountered. It just works really well. I've like figured it out. I don't know. This, I think what I'm really trying to say overall is that the user experience of the hardware, just the hardware, I made it. It was like, it's made for me. And I realize that that's not an objective thing by any means, but if you happen to be like me and single, no, I'm just kidding. Just kidding. I would rather date someone that compliments me. You know that. Anyhow, let's go over this one more time. Windows Hello is amazing. The keyboard is amazing. Cloud computing is a lot better than I thought it would be. The 3:2 aspect ratio would be worth so many, like, you could forgive this computer for a lot as a writer or heavy web reader because of its 3:2 aspect ratio, I'm guessing. Since these computers are like the beta betas of the PC industry, in theory, that we'll see more of that aspect ratio. However, there was a piece published last year in the Register, which is a reputable publication, surely, which the headline is 2019, the year that Microsoft quits Surface hardware. This was published in October of last year. And this is speculation, but Satya Nadella did say, oh my God, this is funny, that they were going to exit the product line, that's a quote, because he is a, quote, software guy, a clown guy, and pointed to the demise of the smartphone line. He added, the Surface performance is choppy. There are good quarters and bad quarters. We're not making money. It doesn't make sense for them to be in this business. How did you forget why you did this in the first place? Oh, yeah, because you aren't CEO. Well, it was great while it lasted. I guess what I'm going to choose to take away from that, the positive thing, instead of being like, wow, I really found a computer that just feels right for me. And of course, there's probably not going to be another one. Instead of saying that, I'm going to choose to say, well, I should just take care of this because one day it's going to become a collector's item that I will never sell. It'll just be cool because I'll be like, yeah, you know, I'm a Microsoft kid. I'll kind of like, I don't know, imply that I got this laptop is like some sort of reparations for my elementary school age mental trauma because of Microsoft's failed experimental curriculum. Oh, and my friend has an original Surface Tab, which she really kind of hates because she really just needed a laptop. But that was when, I mean, getting a Surface for your kid was like a big deal. Like they were like, wow, this is cool. This is the future. So her parents got her a Surface tablet instead of a laptop for school. And now she just has to deal with its horrendous keyboard. And the worst thing is, like, there's no easy way to just be like, oh, I have another Bluetooth keyboard and set it in front of the screen. Yeah, but that's the original Surface. I covered enough why the laptop is my bet for the most important of the line. I think it's kind of odd that most people seem to be like, yeah, I just want a laptop. And of course, Apple will be like, absolutely, no touchscreen. You didn't want to touch the web anyway. That's the one thing I would change about this computer is that just in my experience, they're, you know, again, I guess it's the grease in my hands, but it just doesn't make sense, especially since it's not a convertible, to include the touchscreen. I don't need to touch the web. The touchpad is great. I don't need to touch the web. But then again, it's actually really easy to disable. So what do we learn? I don't know. Did you learn anything? Send me some money. Send me feedback. On Anchor, if you're listening on Spotify, well then, shucks, you've made it a long way. I hope you're not asleep. Anywhom, once again, you can find my Microsoft Surface Laptop 2 review, the most timely by far hardware written examination in my history, which is to say it's within a year of when it released. That's it, bilge.world/surface. Alternatively, you can just go to bilge.world and then hit software because, yeah, it just, yeah, it's not soft. You know what I mean. It's a package. Yell at me about Windows or what I said about macOS or literally anything. And when I say that, I mean anything. I'd love to hear from you, even if it's just to tell me that you hate my voice or that you think I am wasting my time. And yeah, I'll get right back to you. So it's bilge.world, NeoYokel now on Twitter, but bilge.world/federated is where you can find me on the more relevant, the future of social networking. I pledged to finally finish the Bandcamp essay by the end of the year. It's gonna be tough for me, I can't guarantee it, but then again, I think there's literally only one person who is anticipating it at all. It's actually really good. it really is so far. So, yeah, you can contact me a lot of fucking ways, man. A lot of fucking ways. This has been End User. Remember, please, that Microsoft, after all that I said, Microsoft is a really terrible company. Look up Embrace, Extend, Extinguish, and Bill Gates ruined my life. Fuck you, Dad. Fuck you, Bill, little weasel. Oh, and happy Christmas, I guess. Happy holidays. I don't understand. If I have time, I'll be vlogging on Christmas. Bill, stop.
We want to be free! What do you want to do? have a good time. We're gonna have a party. Yeah!